completely ruined, and now we're gonna see the haste ring being picked up. Sorry about that, guys. I have no idea why the stream canceled on itself. I'm gonna send a message over to Twitch right now. Anyway, so we're back.
Aid.
Sorry about that, guys. I think I got it up almost as soon as
Dire's
it went down.
Tower.
Unfortunately,
it's
I wasn't able to notice it right away. But look at this. I mean, Miracle. There's a reason Faceless Void was actually being shown as an offlaner more often not than in the TI. In fact, he had a higher success rate as an offlaner than he did as a one position. There's a reason for that, right? He has a huge amount of survivability, so it's okay to leave him in these sort of situations. Look at Miracle, just go ham, jumps up. If you can get another bash or a couple more, Zhang Zai getting low, last bash, not gonna do it. And Mosin also taking a secondary bash for the Lifestealer. But Miracle Man picking up the very fast, like he went for the poor man's shield early, which is great. Turns that into a quick set of agility treads. And again, the Lifestealer very susceptible to that physical damage early on. Another clash in the middle lane. Chibi starts going on DDZ, but again, Refraction offers him nothing there. DDZ actually using a couple of his remnants there to try and provide some extra damage. Chibi going in once again, just trying to lay down any harassment he can at this point in time. Of course, DDZ, always the advantage in an Ember Spirit. Lay down a Remnant, go back to base, and can come right back. Faceless Void, there it is. He dropped the Chrono in the bottom lane. Now going to start going for Mosin as well. And with the Disruption, this should be a very easy kill. There's going to be a Fissure that comes out. Miracle starts tanking up the tower. Mosin's actually going to be able to get away top lane. We do have the Razor, who's able to pick off the Skywrath Mage as both Pelosin and X-Freed and went for another dive this time around. It does not pay out any dividends for them. 3-2, 6 minutes in. And action on both the side lanes at the same time. Man, it's been too long since I did camera work, I guess. Chibi finding himself a double damage rune, so if you couldn't ask for more physical damage in the world. Templar Assassin going straight Refraction and now picking up a DD. DDZ is not going to be too happy with that one at all. Still, though, I mean, you take a look at the gold graph, I would say Scythe are still leading, despite the fact they fed away a couple kills in the top lane. They should still be leading just because CS is still heavily in their favor between Miracle as well as the Templar Assassin. And DDZ, well, you can see him. He's going for the extra levels into Flame Guard, but he's going to need some additional help, and that's why we have the smoke up with the two supports. Both Earthshaker and Shadow Shaman are coming in. And there goes the Fissure, laid down. Now they're going to lay down that damage over time for Chibi. Silenced up instantly by the Skywrath Mage, stopping that lasso. And the Ember Spirit will actually jump away from this engagement, not wanting to fight. MTR is going to go down. Mosin, that double damage just ripping through him with the last nuke from the Skywrath Mage, will be able to secure the kill. Chibi, though, overextends himself as DDZ is able to make the jump and get a return kill at the very least. Killing the mid in exchange for two supports, that's not a bad trade. But at the same time, Zhang Zai does not stand a chance up against Miracle in this spot. Lane, who didn't even have to use the Chronosphere in order to get that kill. It's just a straight harassment that Miracle is laying down on this Lifestealer. Lifestealer just can't man up against a Faceless Void like this,
Dire's
not between the two different passives, the backtrack as well as mainly the time block. It's too dangerous for him. Not even a high level of Feast would be able to save him at this point in time, so he has to have a support down here. And yet at the same time, an Earthshaker in the mid lane is not enough for them to be able to obtain a kill on the Templar Assassin. So they're just stretched so far, so thin right now due to the strong laning phase of Scythe. And this is where this Razor is going to have to come into play. They're leaving him a lot of room in this top lane to farm up, and he's utilized it in order to pick up a fast mech. But he needs to demonstrate that that investment of time was worth it for Arrow. So maybe he needs to go into the mid lane, take over for this Ember Spirit, and allow Ember to sit at the top lane and start doing some farming. Oh, DDZ, how unfortunate there that the chains did not land on Chibi. It wouldn't be a kill by any means, but he could have used that extra bit of harassment for sure. Shadow Shaman picking up level 6 is going to be the next upgrade for Arrow Gaming. If they can combine the Razor's inherent mid-game power in team fights with some 3 to 5 man pushes, just get a couple of heroes together, force some team fights around this mech, and start taking down some towers with the Shadow Shaman wards. That's, I think, the best play for Arrow, but they're going to go for another gank in this middle lane where Chibi, he's playing around with this. I think he's feeling pretty scared. He's been ganked time and time again. It would make sense that Arrow Gaming would keep on the same path, especially since he doesn't have the 2 supports to be able to help him out this time, and that's because Lance is about to feel the rotation coming in. Freedom is going to be able to see him there for a second, gets off the slow. Lance, he's going to be copping a lot of damage here, but he still has the mech. He should still easily be able to get away from this one. Blosin is going to have to blow the ultimate possibly. There goes the Ravage. Lance getting low, will be nuked down in time. Blosin is going to be cleaned up at the same time as Kopi will, as Zhang Zai made a teleport in. X-Freedom was able to get himself out of the lane. But they still lost a 2-for-1. Still, they killed the Razor as well as cleaned up a lot of room for the 2 different solos here in the mid lane as well as bottom. DDZ is going to try and go for a kill onto Chibi, but it's just not possible, especially with Refraction coming back up in just a few seconds. But Miracle completely free farming this bottom lane, and I'm almost expecting him to go ahead of Midas at this point in time. DDZ is going to be caught as here comes that Faceless Void. Leap up, gets the Chronosphere, catches out DDZ, and now all he has to do is click him once. Nice and easy. So Miracle, I love that play from him, because I was just about to say, Faceless Voids have been playing a lot more aggressively going into these early rotations. I think every single time Chronosphere, you shouldn't go more than a minute with Chronosphere being off cooldown. And Miracle, he had it off cooldown for about a minute, minute and a half there, but he made a strong rotation just to be able to ensure the kill into the Ember Spirit. And no minus for him. He's going to go straight for a Mask of Madness. I like this build. It's a very aggressive build that allows you to be a much stronger force early on, and it gives them a lot of solo killing power. Midas will certainly get you to level 16 very quickly, which is a big strength for Faceless Void. Obviously, the lower cooldown of your Chronosphere, the stronger impact you have in these team fights. A more consistent impact, I should say. Which is great and everything else, but at the same time, Midas will be gimping your damage enough that you may not be able to obtain these kind of solo kills. But with this build, Miracle can sit in the bottom lane and no solo can go up against him. I mean, even the Razor would be seriously threatened by a Faceless Void, making a leap, getting a couple of hits in, and then laying down that that Chronosphere.
Radiant's middle tower.
Arrow, now going to start grouping up, and there's your first set of Serpent Wards. They're going to try and take this middle lane tower. Scythe don't necessarily have to try and defend this. They've already got 2 different solos getting out. Top lane, oh, Skywrath Mage. Unable to make the teleport, and it looks like they will go for the defense here. Chibi already in position to start cleaning up those wards. Very aggressive set of wards there. Normally, if you're in these sort of positions where you can't guarantee taking the tower like that, the wards should be placed back here, where they aren't going to be easily taken out. Because it means the heroes have to actually put themselves in a dangerous position to start cleaning up those wards. Top lane, we're going to have Miracle once again. Level 2 Chronosphere, and he's going to be using it on Zhang Zai this time around. Lifestealer just... Poor guy, man. What can he do about this? Like, he could have gone for maybe Treads, but that still wouldn't give him enough stats to be able to survive. Plus Treads, that mobility is still a better option for Lifestealer in general. He's going for the drums, so he's still getting a decent amount of stats, but he just can't stand up against the Faceless Void. Scythe are simply building off of a better laning exchange and have become to a point where their carry is unstoppable.
Middle tower is under attack.
Their Templar Assassin can one-on-one the Ember Spirit constantly. So Arrow Gaming have to be making the better rotations. It seems that Scythe are always one step ahead of them. Even a successful gank like this is going to cost them a lot here. Is Chibi? He should go down here. There should be no possibility of Chibi getting out. He's going to pop the Refraction, but Burn is still going to be enough. Mosin even popping the Echo Slam there at the last second. Kopi, who teleported in, try and help out his ally, is going to be caught in the process. And that's going to be adding in a secondary death to the fire. There goes a nice little Ravage and a 3-man tied. Coming in with the Anchor Smash, he's still going to be caught out. 5 heroes from Arrow grouping up and taking down a 3rd member of Scythe. It was a very ballsy play by him. The attempt at Ravage just did not work out at all. as DDZ's going to teleport away. That should have been a simple trade for Scythe. Give away the Templar Assassin in exchange for Miracle claiming that tier 1 tower, and yet Scythe felt they were strong enough to take a fight without their Faceless Void, and clearly they were not. Arrow Gaming were more than willing to 5-man into that. So not only do they get two additional kills off of what should have been just a 1-man game, they get two additional kills, but also claim the middle tier 1 tower. Faceless Void finding Zhang Zai once again, man. It's just not fair.
We all owe a life. I take
yours. I just simply, I don't think this Lifestealer was a great pickup. It's clearly not paying off any dividends now, but just think of how many offlaners. Then you could have actually had a full defensive tri-lane, full 2-man rotations between the Shadow Shaman and the Earthshaker. Earthshaker would not have had to sit in the bottom lane and try and block off if you had regular offlaning, something like, hell, even a Clockwork. You know, a good hero versus somebody like you're running three different melees, essentially. Cogs is a wonderful ability. Even if you can't hold in the Faceless Void, you can still do an excellent job bouncing these heroes out of the way and giving a lot of room for your Razor and Ember Spirit to use their abilities. Because right now, Razor, I mean, Razor's tanky enough, but Ember Spirit especially as a hero likes to sit on the back line and just continually hit those sleight of fists and not really get too much in the brawl, at least when we start dealing with major physical damage like the Faceless Void has. So I really feel that the last pick coming out from Arrow just completely screwed their picks there. Lance, we're going to see him go straight for that Aghanim Scepter, despite the fact he's dealing with Ravage and the Skywrath Mage. It's not too much of a surprise for me. DDZ's going to be running into 3-man. The instant silence comes out. DDZ is actually going to be saved there from the mech. Gets off his good sleight of fist, bouncing around a little bit more. Will be able to survive as the Skywrath Mage goes down. Now Lance trying to catch up to Kopi. He turns around, gets a quick disruption off. It's going to cost him his life, but a beautiful Chronosphere is going to be able to lock down DDZ as well as Matero. That's going to be a 2-man kill there for that Chronosphere. Miracle trying to get out. Good Ravage goes out, and here comes the turn once again. As GB comes in, starts laying in that minus armor onto Lance, who's dealing with Miracle as well. He's going to go down Zhang Zai as well as Earthshaker, will both be able to teleport themselves away. So a great team fight there from Scythe. What originally turned out to be a simple gank on the Ember Spirit turned slightly sour, but Scythe were still strong enough to be able to persevere. Excellent heads-up play there from Miracle as he turned around and hit that 3-man Chronosphere, giving him two different kills, and now going to go for a third one here. Mosin going to be held in by that Bash. He needs the extra help here, and that's where the Gush is going to come in. BKB activated. Miracle, sure enough, gets the kill despite a good War Trap there from MTR. It's not enough, and all it really adds is more gold to Scythe to be able to play around with. DDZ, knowing that Chronosphere is on cooldown as well as the Ravage, is going to try and go for a kill. And looks like they're going to go for Chibi. There goes that Silence, though. Has to get away. Silence is going to run out soon, though. And the Sleight of Fist plus the Chains will be able to ensure the kill onto the Templar Assassin. Now we start going for X Freedom. And that should be another easy kill for DDZ. Good attempt by X Freedom. Knowing that he's going to die, might as well turn down. Turn around, lay down the ultimate, and see if he can at least kill DDZ or, the very minimum, put some damage down before he goes out. Miracle. You know, I wasn't sure if he was going to go for a BKB. The two supports, huge amount of disables, so there isn't the incentive from them, but heroes like the Razor, Lifestealer, as well as, hell, even the Ember Spirit, are not that, like, they're not so threatening they usually go with BKB. I think he's just wanting to be able to make sure that when he does jump in, he's not going to be interrupted by a Fissure or a Shadow Shaman Hex. Like, this just ensures that he will always give Scythe the advantage in these teamfights. Because his Chronosphere simply cannot be countered at this point. The most that Arrow can do is try and ward trap him after he time leaps. They have no other holding abilities.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Nice little rune for Chibi there, the bottom lane. He grabs himself a regen rune. Gotta have some items coming up here. So we have the drums for the Lifestealer. DDZ picking it up in an Ogre Club. Looks like he is going to be going for a BKB. This is one of those heroes. I compare Ember Spirit a lot to Storm Spirit. in the fact that both heroes want to be able to go for damage-dealing items. For example, Storm Spirit loves his Orchid. Ember Spirit would love to be able to have a Battle Fury or a Maelstrom, but it's simply not feasible because he has to go for a defensive BKB first item. Miracle's going to be going on. Lance here did get off the damage drain, which is going to be able to increase his survivability slightly, but not quite enough in the end.
Is under attack. Radiant's bottom tower is under
BKB
attack.
Was used in order to deal with that Fissure, and no! Big Ravage here is going to be able to catch out too. They're going to go for Mosin, and even though this is a Ravage just for a support hero, this ensures Scythe will be able to take the tier 2 tower relatively easily here. And maybe even go for more. Scythe, Velos is going to be gone on by DDZ. Good defensive disruption, but in the end, it's just going to set him up for death, I think. No, no nukes are going to be able to come out. Lifestealer, whose silence gets blown up by the Skywrath Mage ultimate. And DDZ walks himself away from that team fight without the Razor ready to go. There's no possibility of them going for a team fight, which is why the Tidehunter jumped in the first place. If Razor's down, they find an additional pickoff like that. It's an easy team fight for them to take. Mech as well as the Blink Daggers up for the Tide. He's also going to be going for a Refresher, presumably off of that Robe of the Magi. Yeah, there it is. I was just about to say, Miracle's going to be picking up something big soon, and that's going to be the Maelstrom into a Mjolnir. Chibi as well has a decent set of items. He went for the pure mobility route. I would expect him to go for a BKB as well at this point in time, but lots to see. Chronosphere in the mid lane catches out three. Mosin's going to go down because of it. Miracle now pops his BKB at the last second of that Chronosphere, ensures a secondary kill on a support, and teleports away just like that. Again, nothing they can do to be able to stop that BKB Void, especially when he catches most of the disabling heroes. Kopi, coming too close to the sun, is going to be burnt by DDZ. So in the end, at 1 for 2. 19-14, though, Scythe still clearly in head in this game, over a 10,000 gold lead and over a 10,000 experience lead as well. Yeah, there it is. The eventual refresher pickup between the Templar Assassin as well as the Faceless Void. Easily, Scythe have the better late game here. Arrow Gaming certainly can contest if they had a large amount of farm, if they were on even grounds with Scythe, but it's simply not the case. Like, an Ember Spirit is a great hero going into late game, but he's heavily countered by the Faceless Void. Faceless Void is the two things that an Ember Spirit hates most, which is just raw physical damage and a very strong disable. So really, what hope does an Ember Spirit have against just any void, let alone a void that is exceptionally farmed? Scythe are winning this game so hard that they're willing to be able to use Ravage on just simple one-hero pickoffs, and that is something that they may consider here. There it goes! Ravage being used on DDZ, and they simply blow him up with all that magic damage. Who cares about Flame Guard? That is only going to absorb 500 of the no doubt 15, bordering on 2,000 magic damage coming out from that combo. Actually, Mystic Flare only being level 1. I thought that was at least a level 2 there, which is 1,000 damage all by itself, couple arcane bolts, plus a gush. Still, the silence as well being a huge benefactor.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Simple jump forward there from Pelosin without the Ravage. Pretty greedy from him. Fortunately, was able to get away, but the secondary disable is going to put a Dire's stop to his retreat for now. Zhang Zai, though, overextending himself, and now here comes that physical damage we were talking about, and the Chronosphere over the backside is going to be able to go for Lance, and Miracle, now popping his BKB in time, is stunned up for a second, allowing Lance to be able to get off his mech, but it doesn't make the difference. Mosin is going to be chased down inside the tier 3, and DDZ, well, he gets off a good chains there, but he's all by himself. Scythe just steamrolled through the four heroes of Arrow Gaming, and are now set to be able to go uphill just like that. Tier 2 down, why not go up to the tier 3 and at least see if they can take a Rax before the rest of the Arrow squad is back up.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Look at that net worth, though. Top 3 net worth on the board, all belonging to the Scythe members. 16,000 by 24 minutes for Miracle. Very impressive gold per minute rate. 700
Dire's bottom tower has fallen.
Miracle finishing off his Mjolnir is going to be jumping away. Already the poor Shadow Shaman, man. Now the Earthshaker as well. The only hope. The only hope for our poor Lifestealer was jumping inside a creep, but now he could easily be silenced up. And, well, actually, good chance is going to be able to hold him out. Miracle opts not to go for that straight carry. Miracle says, you want to fight? You've got it, man. I've got Chronosphere up. He's going to go first for Shang Tsai. Turn around, throw out the Chronosphere eventually here. He's waiting for it. There it goes. Now gets it on the Lance. Miracle copping a good amount of damage from that Eye of the Storm, but it doesn't make the difference. DDZ, he's forced to leap himself away back to the mid lane, and sure enough, GG, well played, is the call from Arrow. As Scythe take this first game in the quarterfinals of the joinDOTA League Asia. Crushing. Just absolutely crushing Arrow. I mean, there was just no contest whatsoever. From the laning phase, Scythe had an exceptional start. And then from there, going into the mid game, naturally, they had the better late game. Their two of their strongest cores, the Templar Assassin, as well as the Faces Void. The Faces Void especially were strong counters to both the Lifestealer as well as the Ember Spirit. All they were left with, I felt the only hero that could have made a difference here for Arrow was going to be that Razor. And just, there's only so much a Razor can do, man. He can't 1v5. So that's going to be it for Game 1. Game 2 coming up in just a few minutes.